thought of those speech here. I forgive you for needing to refer to writing. I'm very glad to see you all here today. I'm acknowledging that we are on Coast Salish, the Squamish Nation, and other First Nation territory, and thank Councillor Deborah Baker for her permission to proceed on these traditional lands. And my name is Judy Hanazawa, and I'm a member of the Japanese Canadian Working Group. The Working Group became active in response to contact from Japanese Canadians who were seeking our community service to address the late former Reverend Boichi Gordon Nakayama's history over more than 50 years as a sexual abuser of mostly boys and young men in the Japanese community. Other members of our current working group in alphabetical order are Ben Cordback, Joyce Chong, Lisa Ueda, Lorraine Oikawa with UMC, Naomi Shikaze, and Ron Ishimura. Ron was unable to be with us today, but others are here to be helpers today. The names of past members have been printed on the back of today's program, and the current working group appreciates the hard work of past members as well. I should mention that the list should have included David McIntosh, who was a committee member back in 2006. And we also acknowledge Nancy Kumori, who over many years continued to support the community process to address Mr. Nakayama's abuse. We have been working with representatives of the Anglican Church since February 2014, and these representatives are the Venerable Douglas Benton, Executive Archdeacon, Diocese of Manchester, the Very Reverend Peter Elliott, Christchurch Cathedral Rector and Dean, Father Moses Damon M., Priest in Charge, Holy Cross, Japanese Canadian Anglican Church, and earlier meetings in 2014 were also attended by the Venerable Dr. Ellen Court King, who was then Christchurch Cathedral Regional Archdeacon. Now, here is some background. It's going to be a little bit long, so, but I think you should have a picture of how things came about. An early step in our community process was in November 2006, when community members met with Dr. Wendy Fletcher Marsh, who was Dean of Vancouver School of Theology. Dr. Fletcher Marsh informed the community group she would communicate with the Diocese of Calgary to find out whether they had knowledge about Mr. Nakayama's history. And for a variety of reasons, we did not do that. We were given unconfirmed information later that the Diocese of Calgary had sealed Mr. Nakayama's file. And after February 12, 2014, which is quite a few years later, and throughout the spring of 2014, we met with the church to obtain archival information about Mr. Nakayama and address their preparation to support survivors and families. Together, we considered how the church and the community could coordinate in offering support in the national community. In March 2014, Joy Kodama and Brother Reverend Timothy Nakayama made a statement, which was published in our national community news magazine, Bulletin, explaining the possibility of all those who were harmed by their father and their profound grief as members of his family. As this community process has been unfolding, the working group recognizes the tremendous challenge it has presented to Mr. Nakayama's children and their families. We feel that as much privacy, respect, and consideration as possible must continue to be given to them. While the church offered a direct pastoral support and considered ways to provide pastoral care to survivors who resided in other areas, the working group reported to the community of all their activities through the bulletin. And through the bulletin also, we provided information about available counseling support services for survivors and their families. We also provided our working group contact information, being aware of the importance of maintaining confidentiality upon survivor families making contact. And contact was made for some families. On April 19th, we facilitated a community meeting at the Blue Cross Church, calling together community members to discuss the best ways to initiate the community process. And one matter which was acknowledged was that most survivors were senior men, approaching 8 years of age and more, and then in the past. Many had also chosen silence about their experience as a way to put the matter behind them. It is important to state here that our working group extends our respect to survivors who have done the matter until they have effectively managed their experience in their own way. It was important to offer time and support, to extend appreciation to those who share their experience, and to encourage healing and closure for Asian survivors, families, friends, and others. In May 2014, an article by the Venerable Douglas Fenton, Executive Archdeacon, Diocese of Westminster, called A Commitment to Truth and Reconciliation, was published in the Bulletin. This article shared details about Mr. Nakayama's 1994 confession of sexual misconduct and the Calvary Diocese's response resulting in his resignation in 1995. In addition to offering his personal support and contact information to survivors and families, Douglas Fenton concluded, "The Anglican Church seeks to provide a place for the truth, no matter how painful it is to hear and to be told, and believing that in so doing, healing may begin to occur. Only when the truth is told can reconciliation begin." In May 2014, meetings between the working group and the church began to focus upon the apology of the church. Our working group received guidance from survivor families who recommended points to include in drafting the apology. We facilitated another community meeting on June 14, 2014. In this gathering was attended by Dr. Joseph of Reconciliation Canada and Swamish Nation Elder Gloria Wilson. The meeting provided therapeutic information, a presentation about the Japanese community past and present community response to Mr. Nakayama's case, as well as Chief Joseph's invaluable information about his experience as a residential school abuse survivor and his personal healing journey. Dr. Joseph and Dr. Wilson expressed from their own experience that sharing the truth about the abuse was essential to beginning the healing process, as they offered their kind support to Japanese community survivors and their families. From August 2014 until January 2015, our meetings with the church were focused upon jointly drafting the apology. We learned by the fall of 2014 that the Anglican Parliament of Canada assisted in developing the wording, and that the Diocese of Calgary would assume a primary role in developing the final draft. From January through March 2015, the Church completed their work on the final apology. And by May 2015, upon the Church's completion of the apology, our joint work focused upon planning and organizing today's historic. And throughout our meetings over the last year and a half, we have seen that the church representatives who work with us have demonstrated compassion and responsibility, purpose in lighting the truth, and support for healing, reconciliation, resolution, and well-being for Japanese communities.